Good morning, everybody. Today we will have the talk by Dr. Corrado Triglio, and he will talk about auroral radioemission in stars and exoplanetary system. Dr. Corrado Triglio will be introduced by Isabel Marquez, which is our scientific director. Thank you, Isabel.
Hello, good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for coming again to this Severo Ochoa colloquia at the IAA. And moreover, I mean, I acknowledge especially Dr. Corrado Triglio for accepting our invitation. Very welcome, Dr. Triglio. And thank you very much for having accepted the invitation that I'd like, first of all, to extend to an in-person one when the situation will allow that. Dr. Corrado Triglio is a senior researcher at the Osservatorio Astrofisico di Catania in Italy, which belongs to the INAF, to Italian INAF. After his degree and PhD, both obtained at the Catania University in Italy, he started his career working as researcher at the Noto VLBA station of the Istituto di Radioastronomia in Italy, that belongs to the CNR, Italian CNR, with the role of responsible of the observations and the VLBI friend. Later on, he moved to the Osservatorio Astrofisico di Catania, where he contributed to establish the group of radio astronomy focused on galactic radio astronomy. He's a professor of radio astronomy in the University of Catania since 2005, contributing to the training of many students and young researchers. A role that is very, very much needed. His main scientific interests are in the field of radio stars and galactic radio astronomy in general. And recently he's been oriented towards the full exploitation of the scientific returns of the Square Kilometer Array and its precursors and pathfinders, and include many active international collaborations. He's also active in the field of technology, as he has been leader of the work package for the control of the SKA dishes, local monitor and control in particular, during the design phase of the SKA. Now he's also involved in the Meerkat Plus project for the control of the dishes. His interests are always focused on radio astronomy, being a member of several scientific committees related to the SKA project. Today, as you know, he will talk about auroral radio emission in stars and exoplanetary systems. You are very welcome, and we are grateful. We gratefully acknowledge your contribution, Dr. Triglio, and the board is yours.
Thank you for your introduction, Isabel. I'm very happy to be here with you, and I hope that I can come in Granada, because we have also a collaboration with Miguel, and so I want to go in person. Okay, I will talk today. Can I share the screen? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So this is. One of the topics that I like, a lot, because I worked in this field for several years and I'm still working. I started with working in stars with magnetospheres many years ago, and now we are evolving toward the radioemission from exoplanetary systems. So I want to speak about magnetosphere at the beginning. Magnetosphere in stars and also in planets and exoplanets, because we have that magnetosphere with the dipolar typology are present in hot stars, but also in ultra-cool dwarfs and planets. And they are so different kind of stars, object in general, that share similar behavior at radio wavelengths. For example, they have non-thermal radio emission, gyrosynchrotron, So there is some acceleration process. What is the causes, the acceleration process? This is one of the important point. And they show also coherent emission that is interpreted as electron cyclotron maser of the type of auroral radio emission. So one problem is, what is that link? This so different object in the radio behavior. So, okay, this is the HR diagram in radio, radio wavelength, and we have that this kind of magnetosphere that I want to talk about are present in at the top of the HR diagrams for example, in magnetic chemically peculiar stars, which are main sequence BA type stars with anomalous chemical abundances and strong magnetic field. And there are also another completely different brown dwarfs, ultra cool dwarfs at the bottom right part of the HR diagrams that are no stars properly without, because there are no nuclear reaction inside and they are fully convective, but they show very strong magnetic fields. And then outside the HR diagrams, planets and exoplanets. Okay, I want to start with the magnetic chemical peculiar stars. First, why there is the chemical peculiarity? The stars show anomalous photospheric abundance of some elements that can be as strong as a million times the abundance of the sun, and can be also under abundance. And this is explained as a problem of relative diffusion. So in the atmosphere, we have that elements with many transition close to the maximum of the radiation are pushed toward the surface. And in this case, we can explain the abundance. And there is another effect due to the strong magnetic field that frees the elements and inhibit the diffusion along the surface. And then we have a concentration of elements connected to the strength of the magnetic field. And we have that for the fact that everything depends on the radiation, there is a dependence on the effective temperature. And spectral type. For example, this is okay, just to see the main model to explain, this is a light curve invisible for one star, and this is the variability of the effective magnetic field, and this is the equivalent width of helium in this case, but everything is connected. And the main scenario is explained by the oblique rotator model. It's an old model. So the stars, the behavior is like a pulsar in some way. And we have the polar topology of the magnetic field with the magnetic axis misaligned respect to the rotational axis. Another important point is that these are hot stars. Hot stars can drive relatively winds. Okay, these are not so hot, the radiation field is not so big as hot stars, but they can have moderate winds that are observable by ultraviolet observation, for example. And what we see that is that there is an outflow from the polar regions, from the magnetic polar regions. And there is also accumulation of plasma in the equatorial belt. The fact that we have magnetic field and ionized stellar wind led to the hypothesis that they can have radio emission, and this is an old question. Okay, we, for this reason, we started, but many people with many research groups, when at the beginning of the sensitive radio interferometers, so VLA, ATCA, and we conducted many targeted surveys, and we have that the detection rate for this kind of object is about 25%, that is connected with the effective temperature. So the hot stars show higher probability to be detected. Everything is consistent with the zero synchrotron emission, and there should be a correlation with the wind, with the mass loss. The spectra are in general quite flat, and this is explained in terms of the fact that we have different layers with different magnetic dipoles, so we have strong magnetic field close to the star, and then weak magnetic field far, and then we can think at the radio spectrum as the sum of many spectral at different layers in the atmosphere. And another important point is that the radio emission is modulated, as for example the other the lines, the visible light is correlated with the rotational period, and in particular with the magnetic field. So we have here the magnetic curves, and we have that the minima of the radio emission is when the magnetic field is in average is zero. This is consistent with an optical thick source. And this is the starting point for a model that we develop. Okay, this is a scenario. Okay, we have the star here. This is the rotational axis and the magnetic field that is misaligned. And we have, but it's probably is better to see here, we have flow of material from the star, the wind, and the material accumulate in the inner part, can flow freely in the polar region, but the particle, the wind follow the magnetic line till we are inside the Alphen surface. Outside the Alphen surface, when the magnetic field is very small, they break the magnetic lines, and there is the generation of current sheets. In current sheets, we have that there is acceleration of particles that can move inside the magnetosphere, where there is a magnetic field, and generate gyrosynchrotron emission. Then the particles are reflected by magnetic mirroring. What is important for this kind of stars is that we can see the magnetosphere are stable in time, and we can see the magnetosphere in different orientations. So we can have a good model that can be used as a template for other stellar envelopes. So we did a two-dimensional model for the radio emission. So just, this is the star with the magnetosphere, just sampling the space and the computing the physical parameters inside the space, as a function of the orientation of the rotation of the star. And so determining the Alphen radius, everything is important. And having also free parameters as, for example, the power law for the acceleration due to the acceleration, so the power law for the emitting electrons. this is a free parameter, so this is an output of our model. And we are quite happy. This is, for example, a simulation, just to show it's impossible to observe also with the VBI some type of emission, because we don't have the resolution, but we can see that the light curve are well represented by the model, both in intensity and in polarization. Okay, and also for spectra, for example, the spectra are in general flat, so but they are different from star to star because of the magnetic field. So the conditions are not exactly the same, but we are able to reproduce, and we are very happy with the model because we can reproduce the spectra of all the sources that we have in this kind of stars. Okay, so we have also the results for, we can determine the mass loss, for example, all the characteristic of the magnetosphere, and for example, the acceleration. This is another important result because we have that the power law for the acceleration, able to reproduce the spectra that we see with a delta that is about 2. And this is also the efficiency of the acceleration process in the current sheet. But what is the correlation between the luminosity and the other stellar parameters as magnetic field, rotation, wind? We expect a correlation with the wind, but now, with the last work, so this is a very, very, very new work, we find an empirical correlation not with the wind, but with the magnetic flux and the rotation. So in some way we find that what is important is the rotational breaking that we can have in this kind of star, more than the winds. So this is a very nice correlation in several order of magnitude, and we can extend also with planet, but this is to see later. Okay. But so we observed a lot of stars, and we concentrated to test the model in one star that is very close. This is Sue Virginis, that is quite close with a strong magnetic field. But observing with in phase, in time, covering all the rotational period of the star, we found that at 20 centimeters, we observed two peaks that are at the same phase as when the magnetic field is zero. And this means, and this is also in V polarization, we have that the polarization is 100% circular polarized. This means that we have a very high directivity and that the radiation propagates perpendicular to the magnetic axis of the star. And all the observation led to the result that this is a cyclotron maser that above the North Magnetic Pole. Another important point is that even if we observe years later, we observe always this kind of these peaks, and so the different. So it's a very stable phenomena. There is no significant variation in time with many observations in 10 years, but more. The difference is always the same, this difference in phase. So this is an important point. This is a stationary phenomenon. Now we have that there are not a lot, because we have 7 stars that show this kind of behavior, but with the same characteristics. Now we have also, thanks to the other observation of other groups, we have also the bandwidth, and this is an important point to understand what is the bandwidth of the cyclotron masser that develop in the polar region in the auroral radio emission. So this is the starting point for our model, because we observe that the masser is at the first harmonics of the cyclotron frequency, and we have that in these stars the frequency, the gyro frequency is much higher than the plasma frequency, and this is one condition for the development of electron cyclotron masser. For the two virgins, we have that the polar magnetic field is 3000 Gauss, and we have that the region, the meeting region, are located in circular annular regions above the pole, depending on the frequency of the, so at high frequency, this is close to the star. And okay, this is the a simulation of the behavior of this kind of emission as a function of the rotational phase. And we are able to reproduce very well the behavior. This is like a pulsar. For this reason, Sue Virginis has been defined also the first stellar pulsar. And a new result that confirm all the scenario is that we observe also for few stars, we observe also auroral emission in X-ray, because we have that the accelerated, okay, the particle are accelerated in the current sheet and moves toward the poles. Some of these particles precipitate in the atmosphere of the star, and we observe X-ray emission that is consistent with the population of electrons and protons that emits at radio wavelengths. So we have emission here in the pole, and we have auroral emission in radio. So this confirms the scenario. But what is electron cyclotron masser emission? Okay, we have that this is a converging flux tube, magnetic flux tube, and the particle accelerating the current sheet and propagates toward the pole. Then there is also a magnetic mirroring. Some of the particle precipitate in the atmosphere, generating aurora, as in the case of X-ray. And but when they are reflected, for because there are some particles that precipitate in the atmosphere, they are not reflected. So in the space of velocity, we have a lack of velocity in the population of electrons. This generate an inversion of population about the energy of the electrons, and this led to a masser, the so-called electron cyclotron masser, that is in the first few harmonics. And this emission is in the emission cone, okay, with an opening angle theta that depends on the velocity of the electrons. So if we want to apply this model with the emission cone to our stars, we have a problem, because in our case, we have, this is the annular ring where there is the condition for the emission. But if we use the hollow cone pattern, we cannot reproduce absolutely the observed light curve, because this is what we should see, and this is what we see. So the hollow cone pattern doesn't apply for CP stars. Hollow cone apply for Jupiter emission, the EODAM, but we will see later this. Instead, we develop a different model, because this is the annular ring where the condition for Maser exists, and we have that if theta is about 90 degrees, we have that the Maser amplification can occur efficiently where the optical path is long, okay? So in what we have at the end is that we have the so-called tangent plane emission. So we see the emission just in two spots, like in this scenario. What we have is that, for example, for the Jupiter, we have this kind of emission. So we observe the Maser in these points. And also for the Earth, for the auroral kilometric radiation from Earth observed from space, we have the same location. Okay, we now are in the direction to study planets, and just to remember what is the scenario for the radio emission from planets of the solar systems. We have that all the planets with magnetosphere in the solar system have show this kind of auroral radio emission that is characterized by pulses, burst, a low frequency that is impossible to see from the Earth because of the ionospheric cutoff. Just we can observe just something for Jupiter. And we have that the radio emission from the planets is very intense, and is more intense of the active sun at this frequency. The frequency of emission is correlated to the magnetic field of the planet. For example, for Jupiter, we have about 12 Gauss at the pole, and we have a higher frequency, but low frequency we can observe from Earth. And another important point is the circular polarization. This is 100% and the spectra that is very broad. So the characteristics are the same as in the star that we observed, that we discussed before. In the planets, we have two kinds of aurore. One type is type one, is the kinetic type that is due to the interaction between the solar wind and the magnetosphere of the planet. When there is a coronal mass ejection, for example, there is that all the magnetosphere is squashed and there is generation of current sheet in the magnetic tail of the Earth in this case, that led to acceleration and propagation of particles toward the auroral, toward the polar regions of the Earth. And we have the aurora that we can observe, but we can observe also in Jupiter and Saturn. And this is what associated also to the electron cyclotron master. The other kind is the so-called magnetospheric, the type 2, and this is due to the interaction between the magnetosphere of the planet and the satellite of Jupiter. We observe this kind of emission in Jupiter, in the Jupiter system. So we have that the satellite Io running around the planet generate triggers the acceleration of particles that propagate toward the planet. This is possible in two cases, in the case of unipolar interaction when there is no magnetic field in the satellite, as in the case of Io, or better in the case that the satellite has a magnetic field, and as in the case of Ganymede for Europa. And in this case, we have that the acceleration of particles is due to the magnetic reconnection. What we have for this, for Io, for example, is that the emission cone works, the emission, the pattern of the emission works fine, and even if there is a complex radio behavior, so the dynamical spectra are quite complicated. Now we can try to understand what is the power, that this is an important point, because we have that for the two kind of interaction, we have an incident power that, for example, for the kinetic scenario, interaction between wind and stellar wind and planet and magnetosphere, we have that the incident power is due to the energy of the wind and from the cross section of the planet. And we can compute the incident power, and we found that for the planet of the solar system that there is a proportionality between the incident power and the radio power. This is also for the second scenario, for the magnetospheric interaction, even if it is different, but this is a little more efficient, few order of magnitude more efficient. What we have is that everything depends on the cross section of the planet, that in this case, for example, depend on the magnetic field of the planet, also in this case. So in some way we can, it's possible, if we have a very good model for this, we is possible to infer the magnetic field of the planet. This is the generalized radio law, because this is the incident power for the solar planet, and this is the power in at radio wavelength, and we can estimate that for, in the case of hot Jupiter orbiting around young stars with strong wind and with strong magnetic field, we should have very high emission. The idea is to find this kind of emission in exoplanet. But I want to focus before going to exoplanet to the radio aurora that we observe in ultra-cool dwarf. Okay, the stars that are not stars, because there are not nuclear reaction inside, but they found that there are about 15 ultra-cool dwarfs that show radio auroras. And the behavior is exactly the same, almost exactly the same as in the case of hot stars. we see peaks that are related to the rotation of the stars, but we have that in general they are not, we don't see for any rotation the peak. But what we have, that if we observe peaks of emission, the peaks appear at the same rotational phase, even if they don't appear at every rotation. If they are at the same rotation, but not always. So we develop a radio aurora model. This is a three-dimensional model that explain the observed emission, auroral emission, as a function of the rotation of the star in a system where the axis of the dipole is misaligned with the rotational one. And we can reproduce this kind of behavior. So we see here the rotating star with the dipole, and we observe an emission when the axis is almost perpendicular to the line of sight. With a little difference delay in the north and south pole due to the refraction, but this is not important in this moment. Okay, remember this pattern of emission, because this I want to call this as the ideal emission for auroral emission. So if the acceleration occur all around the star, we have this, as in the case of hot stars. But for cool stars, as ultra cool stars, we have the idea that the masser can be triggered by the transit of exoplanet near quadrature, okay? So if we observe in this direction, we have that an emission can occur if there are particles accelerated here because of the tangent, the tangent plane emission that we expect. And so we have a small masser here, a small masser here, but not every rotation. This is the scenario. So just in some rotation, we can have that the planet is in the quadrature. And we developed the model, we applied to the stars that we already saw, and we are able to some expectation that depend on obviously the ratio between the rotational period of the star and the orbital period of the planet and of the geometry of the system, but we are able to explain. So this is a possibility. We don't know if these stars has effectively a planet. So it's important also to test with this model with stars that host planet that we know. What is important? Why the auroral radio emission is important for exoplanet? Because they are due to the interaction between the planet and the stars, and so it's possible to study space weather and interaction also led to the possibility to develop in the young atmosphere molecules and but the presence of magnetic field is very important because, as in the case of the Earth, is a shield for the energetic particle from the star, from the wind. and this is important for life protection. If you consider that Mars and Venus don't have a magnetic field, even if they are in the habitable zone, we are just the Earth as so the magnetic field can be very important for the development of the life. So it's important hunting for exoplanet in radio, and there are two ways. One is try to detect the auroral radiation above the planet. So as in the case of the solar system, the kinetic, so due to the wind, but we expect that the frequency of emission, since it's proportional to the magnetic field of the planet, is a very low frequency. So we expect megahertz, tens of megahertz, as in the case of the solar system. And we could observe, for example, with SKA low. Another possibility is the second type, the magnetospheric, induced by the stellar planet interaction. And in this case, we expect frequency that can be up to thousands of gigahertz. The magnetic field can be thousands of Gauss, so we expect high frequency on the order of gigahertz, and this is can be observed, for example, with SKA1 or precursors. So there is the search for auroral emission. I want to show some of the last result in this field. For example, this year, months ago, with LOFAR, expecting the survey, LOFAR 2 meters sky survey, they found that in two observation, Vadetam, found that there is a star that emit in circular polarization, and in the second observation, no. So they propose the possibility that this is due to the star-planet interaction. And this is possible, but for this star, there were not a planet. So, but a planet was supposed a few months ago, a few months later, with ARPS Nord and other instruments, but at the end was ruled out. So we have that we observe this kind of radiation, but it is not confirmed the presence of a planet. So we don't know if these stars emit due to the interaction with the planet. We are just to understand what we are doing as a group. We search auroral radiation at high frequency in every planetary system, obviously. What we think, I think that it is important to sample the orbit. The first try we did was with Alpha Centauri B with ATCA when there was the discovery of the planet around the star, but we don't observe it, but we don't observe, we not found anything. At the end, there was the result that there was no planet. This is, was an error in the analysis of the data. We did also for TRAPPIST-1, 2 years ago, that is a star that hosts a planetary system with 7 planets, but we didn't find anything because there is a very strong source in the field that doesn't allow to reach a good signal to noise ratio. So we have no detection. Now we are working on the T-Garden star with the observation with the VLA, and okay, this is the field and this is the position of the star, but the reduction is in progress. I want to stress the fact that it is important to sample the orbit of the planet, because we expect that the emission is near in quadrature, when the planet is in quadrature. And now, just to finish, I think that this is the first detection of auroral radio emission in an exoplanetary system, in the nearby star that is Proxima Centauri. And this is a paper that we did in collaboration with Miguel. And this is what we observe, for example, okay, in Stokes I, in the total intensity, we detect the source in not every time. We did observation in 18 days. And we detect the source when the planet is in quadrature. So when the planet, so this is the line of sight, and we detect the planet. We detect the emission when the planet is. Another important point is that we have a very high degree of circular polarization. That is what we expect for the cyclotron master. So, and considering also the result that about the magnetic field of the star, we have that there is a component of the magnetic field that is dipolar, consistent with the dipolar typology, and okay, there are the characteristic of the system, and with our model we can show some possible auroral pattern in this okay, in this period. So for example, if we can see that our model is consistent with what we observe, and we are quite happy with this result. This is just to finish what not in scale, obviously. This is the planet around Proxima Centauri that trigger acceleration of particle in the orange lines, and we can see the masser in the north or in the south pole that give circular polarization depending on the side, north pole or south pole. Just to conclude, I can say that the magnetic, chemically peculiar stars are a perfect, the most not perfect, but anyway, the best laboratory for the study of the polar magnetosphere and also auroral radio emission. We have the model for the auroral radio emission from exoplanetary system due to star-planet interaction is very promising in the case of type 2 interaction that we can detect at high frequency. And this is a model that uses the tangent plane model for the radio emission. And in this case, but this is not easy because it's model dependent. We can detect and give an estimate of the planetary magnetic field with all the important consequences that we can have in this field, in the field of the life in other planets. So what is, I think that is important is to carry on some survey of no nearby planetary system, sampling the orbit. So it's important to test the model when we are sure that there is a planet. And this is very promising for new telescope, in particular for the SKA precursors and SKA in the following. So I finish here, and if you have any question, I'm here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Corrado. Very nice talk, I like it. And now the talk is open for questions. For doing the question, please raise your hand, and I will let Miguel Perez Torres to manage all this session. So please raise your hand for doing the question, and Miguel, session.
Okay, thanks.
Yours.
I think I saw Alejandro Dominguez raising his hand. Do you have a question, Alejandro? First of all, while Alejandro decides whether he raised his hand or not, thank you very much, Corrado. Very, very interesting, very nice talk. And I think you mentioned everything. I understand now better a number of things, and I'm happy that we started this collaboration with you and Paolo and Grazia. So I look forward to continue with this collaboration. Alejandro?
We have to continue because it's just a question of time, unfortunately.
Yes, I know, you're very busy. Okay, so maybe, Alejandro, could you just in the chat, I'll check the chat too. Sorry.
Saying that clapping.
So he was clapping, not raising his hand. Okay, so Corrado, he was clapping for your talk, I think he does right. So, okay, maybe just to warm up, I can start with a question, something that actually interests us both, your group, Corrado, and our group, is that actually we understand that it's very important to determine the planetary magnetic field. So we think that is actually very useful to use it. Well, we think that the magnetic interaction, the type 2 interaction you mentioned, is the one that is most promising, definitely. But then anyway, the problem in a way is that the magnetic field that is also very relevant there is the magnetic field of the star. So I guess we first need also to, I mean, in the equation, what we have is the magnetic field of the star and the magnetic field of the planet, because it goes with the cross section, right? With the magnetosphere, the magnetopause is higher because of the magnetic field of the planet. But the other B, the B that you have in the formula, this big B, is actually the one of the star, right? Well, or the position where we have this. So I'm trying to push, and I think, let me see, Pedro Amad is around here. Yeah, to actually somehow we should understand better, have better estimates of the magnetic field of the star. So what are your thoughts? Could you elaborate or just give your opinion on this? Because maybe, I mean, we kind of try to get to model the planetary magnetic field via this fantastic model that Paolo and you have developed. But maybe the main thing is that we don't know very well the magnetic field of the stars. I was surprised, you may know, that the Proxima Centauri magnetic field now was decreased from 600 to 200 Gauss. So I don't know what to think.
Give a comment for this, because when there was the discovery of Proxima Centauri B, I was thinking to apply for ATCA, but then I thought that Proxima Centauri is a very active star, so there are a lot of flare, there are a lot of coronal mass ejection, And I think that it's very difficult to find this kind of observation. Then I applied for the garden, for TRAPPIST-1. That is a quiet star, there is no activity, there is no coronal mass ejection, that is stable, normal star. And I was very surprised when you showed me the result of Proxima Centauri. I think that there are probably different period of activity. When there is no big activity, there are no flares, there is not coronal mass ejection that are always possible, there is the base dipolar magnetic structure. I think this because Proxima Centauri is a star that is not ultra cool dwarf, but there is some important activity, magnetic activity, as in the case of the Sun, for example. So probably there are moments in which we can observe the magnetic field with the dipolar structure, in moment when we cannot observe the structure is destroyed by the other kind of solar stellar activity. I think this, we will see if this kind of emission is confirmed for the next observation that planned, Miguel.
Because okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the clarifications, Corrado. So anyone is wishing to raise his or her hand? Corrado is an expert, really one of the leading experts in the world. So you are missing a big opportunity not to ask him. Well, I can ask more questions. So maybe just, could you, I always have initial difficulties, and I guess some of people in the audience may have also felt that why in the end, the hollow cone you showed that it doesn't really explain the thing, the pattern. So you and Paolo, your team developed this, you applied this tangent plane. So could you maybe simplify, explain this in more simple words? So
I can show the slide. I don't know if there is, I'm sharing the screen.
You can share the screen. Yes, you can share it.
Moment,
because you can share, but you are not sharing.
No. Okay, here. Okay, share screen. Okay, do you see?
Yeah.
Okay. The fact is that if we apply the hollow cone to all this kind of stars, we cannot reproduce absolutely the observed light curve. This is a fact. So for this reason, we think that the tangent plane is most probable to apply for this kind of stars, but not only for this kind of stars. So it's important to understand when, for example, in the case of Io emission, your Jupiter emission, there is an hollow cone emission. So what is the difference between the two? I don't know. We have to investigate. But the fact is that the hollow cone pattern doesn't apply to MCP stars, doesn't apply to brown dwarfs. And this works for MCP stars, for planets, and for Proxima Centauri B. Why? Probably, I think that one fact is that is linked to the aperture of because the physical the emission is to produce the electron singular masser born with an holocone. But if this holocone is very flat, is theta is about 90 degrees, we can apply this because the emission is in the same plane of the ring. So I don't know exactly. I want to investigate in this point, because but there is a difference.
Okay, okay, thanks for that. Yeah, okay, I understand. Don't worry, Corrado, that's very useful. Hello, guys. And maybe people is hungry. People are hungry and they want to go to eat. But I will keep on because I don't want to miss the opportunity of asking Corrado. So, you know.
Anyway, we can discuss
later on. But yeah. So okay. Well, yeah. You are right. I mean, so if there are no more questions, of course. Let me just one last question. Just so also maybe more for people. So when you mentioned that the aurora radio emission, the bandwidth is basically one or two times the frequent. I mean, delta nu over nu is 1 to 2. Is because I understand that you assume that it's basically everything within the first and the second harmonic or something like that. It's not that we have no idea of how large can it be. It's because basically you're assuming that it's within the first harmonics, the radio emission, or yeah, just a question. So
okay, it's not clear because for example, for the MCP stars, okay, this is an observation made by DAS, Darnley Bass, DAS. We have that is not obvious, is not the same, because for one peak, this is one peak, this is another peak, so this peak and the other peak, the bandwidth is not the same, is approximately one or two times the frequency, the central frequency. It's not easy to, probably there is some variability in also in the bandwidth. Probably it depends also on the configuration of the magnetic field. I think this is one possibility. Probably it depends on the fact that there are other quadrupolar components. So I think that it depends on the typology of the magnetic field. But this is not, we have just, for this kind of stuff, we have just this observation. Because we have to use several instruments different. In this case, they use the VLA, they use the GMRT, and I think probably another telescope. But it's difficult to have simultaneously all the spectrum spanning all of this, the range of emission.
Okay, thank you, Corrado. I think there is a question by Pedro. So go ahead, Pedro. I think who has to unmute? You can unmute yourself.
Sure. I'm trying to start the video, but I can't. Yes, okay. Hi, Corrado. Thanks very much for your nice talk. Can you hear me properly? Yes. Okay, I just would like to make a question or a comment on a very recent result by Robert Kavanagh on the modeling of the planet-induced radio emission from Proxima Zen, where they don't find a suitable scenario for the emission in Proxima B, because in Proxima 10, because it seems that they find that the planet orbits too far away from the star in the supergalvanic regime. And this, of course, is in contradiction a little bit with what we are saying in our paper. And at some point, we will have to reconcile these studies with what we find in Proxima B, in Proxima Centauri. So could you comment on this? How we can reconcile these results?
Yes, this is an important point, because the model works when we are in the subalphanic regime. And they found that, we are in the... this depends on the ratio between the mass loss, the wind, the energy of the wind, and the energy of the magnetic field. So if the magnetic field is quite intense respect to the wind, we are in the subalvanic region. So they found that, I understand that from modeling of the stellar wind, they have that the alvenic, subalvenic region is smaller than the diameter, the radius of the orbit. Anyway, it's not so so far. So it can depend. I don't know if the wind is stable. I don't know if the magnetic field is stable. So probably there are moments in which the magnetic field or the wind is more intense, so this can change, we don't know. But so I think that the result is dependent, very dependent on modeling. So, but anyway, we are not so far. For example, there is another star that is IU microscopy, for which
yes.
They have that the planet is inside the subalvenic region. There is, the wind is different. I think that the results are model dependent anyway.
And they also depend on how they reconstruct the magnetic field and at which time, because it is known that Proxima Centauri has a magnetic cycle of seven years, and depending on when you obtain images, I don't know, seven Doppler imaging. To reconstruct the magnetic field, you may be reconstructing different topologies or getting different strengths for the field, and then this can affect the final results on the estimation of the Alphen surface, right?
Yeah.
Is this correct?
Yes, I think the same. Yeah. So there are a lot of unknown. That it's difficult to rule out, it's difficult to say yes or not.
Yeah, we need more observations and more targets that are detected in radio emission, of course. Thanks, Corrado.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, are there more questions?
Miguel, here is
Antonio.
Corrado, how are you? It was a very nice talk. Let me show my face. I start the video. Now you can show me. How are you? Okay, I have a very short question, Corrado. It's referring to the very short bursts that have been detected also in Proxima Centauri. And these were the minutes with a duration of minutes that have a very high civil polarization. It's around 100%, if I don't remember it badly. What's peculiar about these two flowers in the frame of the models you have shown today?
I think that the auroral emission is a quite stable kind of emission, but there is also the fact that Proxima is a very active star. Probably also this kind of emission is related to the density of the circumstellar matter that I don't think that is constant. So probably there is some coronal mass ejection, I don't know exactly, that can give a momentary input to the maser in some moment, in some peculiar moment. So this is a possibility. But I think that is linked to the fact that the star is a very active star. So this is my feeling. But we have to investigate. So it's not in contradiction. Or, for example, also, this flare here is not in contradiction, it's the same position. So this is possible. That we have this kind of Higer emission. Okay, the model is in the case that everything is constant, but this is not the case. The reality is different from the idealization. and Proxima is a very complex star with circumstellar matter that can change in time. This is my feeling.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Corrado. I think now, there are no more questions. Maybe we should thank you because we are already more than 1 hour and 15 minutes, which is probably, and I see people that start leaving the room. So I know, well, maybe one last question, or if not, I will pass the word to Rene or to Isabel to Isabel. So go ahead, Isabel.
Yes, that I have to unmute myself first. It was just to insist on the invitation in person format in the future, and to say thank you again to you, Corrado, for such a nice and interesting talk. And that's everything. I mean, it's not my, I'm not an expert on this, and I found that extremely interesting. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for inviting me. Thank you.
Maybe we can unmute the microphones and thank clapping really real hands to Corrado. So he's sure that we are clapping him, not just some machine.
I'll have to do it close to the microphone.
The problem that we have, everybody has with the online talks is that we don't see the person. I miss the contact with the people because this is very important for...
We all do. You are absolutely right.
Thank you for this, for clapping, because in some way I can see the...
You can feel that we are really clapping you, right? No, not just some
here,
robot.
Exactly.
Okay, thank you very much, Corrado. Now I think I have to rush to prepare to cook the meal. So I get in touch with you, okay?
Yes, okay, obviously, Miguel. Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Take care.